I had a dream. One day, in 2010, I woke up with this phrase in my mind. You will be able to unravel time. I had never heard the word unravel before, so I looked it up in the dictionary to see if it had any meaning. It did. It meant to undo, to untangle, to solve. And still, what did that phrase mean? How could you unravel time? By only focusing on the how, I had no answer. So I changed my focus to the what. What is time? Time can be perceived as a human concept, a historical guideline, a cultural framework. And still, time cannot be discerned from space. According to Einstein's general relativity, the concept of time depends on the special referential frame of the observer. Time should be addressed more specifically as space-time. For instance, due to a principle of physics known as time dilation, astronauts in space are aging a bit more slowly than the people on Earth. In physics, space-time refers to a mathematical model that combines space and time into a single continuum. Time is added as a dimension of space. Before proceeding further, we should mention that space-time is merely a convenient framework. It does not describe what it really is, but what it is like. It is assumed that space-time is curved. Such a curvature would be caused by the presence of matter and would be responsible for gravity. But what does this has to do with Nietzsche's eternal recurrence? From Das Spoke Zarathustra, on the vision and the riddle. The dwarf marveled contemptuously. All truth is crooked. Time itself is a circle. You spirit of gravity, I said angrily. Do not make things too easy for yourself. Behold, I continued, this moment. From this gateway, a long, eternal lane leads backward. Behind us lies an eternity. Must not whatever can happen, have happened, have been done, have passed by before? And if everything has been there before, what do you think, dwarf, of this moment? Must we not eternally return? Eternal recurrence. I first engaged with Nietzsche's notion of the eternal recurrence when I was 16 years old. The idea that each and every moment of my life could return eternally as the same changed my life at the time, inspiring me to craft my existence as my most ambitious work of art, to which I could say yes eternally. As many Nietzsche scholars, I interpreted the eternal return as a thought experiment. And I must admit that at first, I was surprised when I realized that Nietzsche might have conceived it as a cosmological doctrine as well. Here, I will not enter the debate on whether he actually meant to present the eternal recurrence in one way or in both ways. But I would like to reflect on possible interpretations of it and take it as an inspiration to develop posthuman cosmo-ontological hypothesis based on contemporary developments in the fields of quantum physics. As a cosmological pattern, the eternal recurrence can be traced back to Eastern philosophies and spiritual traditions related to Buddhism as well as Hinduism. Within Western philosophy, we can see antecedents in Heraclitus, the Stoic philosopher Zeno, and the Pythagorean tradition, all sources which Nietzsche was familiar with. Some other interpretations of the eternal recurrence can be found in different cosmogonic rituals around the world. For instance, Mircea Eliade, in The Myth of the Eternal Recurrence, 1949, underlines how ancient societies tended to envisage events not as constituting a linear, progressive history, but as creative repetitions of primordial archetypes. But how could a moment contain the present, the past, and the future at the same time? Eternally, the ring of being remains faithful to itself. In every now, being begins. Round every here rolls the sphere there. The center is everywhere. Bent is the path of eternity. The moment is the matrix of creation. Most patterns of existence will be repeated, ensuring continuity. Some will be slightly modified. Few might be radically revisited. Some interesting philosophical seminars in jail, a friend of mine received this answer from a prisoner who had killed both his wife and her lover when he accidentally found them having sexual intercourse. He said, "In that moment, I thought that killing them was what I was supposed to do. Everyone expected me to do so. If I did not, I would have not been able to look into the eyes of my family and friends. I did not feel like killing them, but that was the only way I knew to deal with the situation. And so I did." Repetitions of behavior. That was the only way he knew to deal with that situation. Patterns of existence. Such a perspective can be applied to many other notions and categories. Judith Butler, in Gender Trouble, 1990, defines gender as performative and reiterative. More than a noun, gender is a verb. To gender, gendering. This is just an example to stress that gender, as well as infinite other micro and macro patterns, are reenacted through the gerundic condition of lived practices. By performing our existence, or more simply saying, by the ways we live, we are creating patterns of existence. Here, it can be of interest to mention Jung's archetypes as universal, archaic patterns and images of the collective unconscious. But how these sort of fluid archetypes would have formed? In order to address this question, I will now go back to our physics scenario, focusing on modalities of existence. In order to delve into the how, which is also the what of our possible futures. The multiverse, is one of the most challenging notions formulated by cosmologists and physicists in the last decade. It is the next step in the human revision of the cosmos. It represents the ultimate decentralization of the human, as well as the final deconstruction of any strict dualisms. First of all, let me clarify that by multiverse, I am referring to the scientific investigations of matter from the micro to the macro levels of materialization, which recently brought different fields from quantum physics to cosmology to astrophysics to the same hypothetical conclusion. This universe might be one of many. Here, I should also mention that the multiverse is not a theory, but a prediction of certain theories, as cosmologist Max Tegmark stresses. For instance, the math of string theory, in order to function, requires a distinct feature, which is extra dimensions of space. Consequently, advancing the hypothesis that this specific dimension is only one of the many occurring. In other words, even if the notion of the multiverse in its radical decentralization of the human is inherently posthuman, the current scientific perceptions of the multiverse are conceived through the self-others, here-there paradigm, in an approach which resonates with humanistic dualisms, based on the necessity of the others as reverse mirrors of the self. Posthumanism is a post-dualism. And so I asked myself, what would a posthumanist approach to the multiverse bring to the discussion as the body? But the knot of causes in which I am entangled recurs and will create me again. I myself belong to the causes of the eternal recurrence. I come again with this sun, with this earth, with this eagle, with this serpent, not to a new life, or a better life, or a similar life. I come back eternally to the same, self-same life, in what is greatest and in what is smallest, to teach again the eternal recurrence of all things. Let's now go back to repetitions and patterns of existence. If we think of ourselves as materializations related to one specific vibrational dimension, we can hypothesize such a dimension as holding specificities related to the ways existence manifests in such a dimension, which would imply something like an ontic nature culture of space-time. In other words, the nature of space-time would not be something static, but correlated to the events manifesting within it, thus related to a dimensional culture made, among other factors, by enactments and modes of existence. The crucial question behind this hypothesis is, does space-time hold memory? Space-time has been defined as the set of all possible events in one universe. Each point in space-time represents an event. Think, for instance, of space-time as a blackboard, and events as points on it. To label a point on the blackboard, you have to imagine laying down a grid. This grid represents the set of possibilities related to each event. Space-time is not a blank canvas. As we previously seen, its own curvature is an effect of the materiality manifesting within it. So, how does each event affect the space-time of one specific dimension? I repeat this question one more time. How does each event affect the space-time of one specific dimension? Does the repetition and reiteration of modalities of existence mark space-time in a way that such patterns, the more they are performed, the more they are likely to be repeated? In a simple way, think the way you walk or drive home. The more you take a road, the more likely you will be to take such a road. And if you have children, or if you have a guest and you show them your way, they will most probably take those same roads. Few would actually try different paths. Let's now offer a monumental example. The pattern of war keeps coming back within human recorded history. Could it be possible that this specific vibrational dimension is more prone to it? Let me develop this point further. On one level, we could hypothesize that war, once present as an event in the memory of space-time, has been repeated enough to become a common pattern of this vibrational dimension. Here, I would like to specify that we should not think of such patterns as fixed, nor as existing in any separate way. Their manifestation would only take place in the performativity of each event, in the moment. The significance of each reenactment, though, cannot be underestimated. Each repetition implies a tuning into and a recreation of specific model genealogies. Each repetition carries a vibrational impact. Every event is related to a certain grid of possibilities. Another related point we may arise is, do specific vibrational states of the streets manifest specific patterns more easily than others? I am hypothesizing about relating to vibrational ranges as a sort of DNA of energy, which will carry specific information that may be enacted or left in potential by the manifestations of existence performing within that specific frequency. Such a DNA would have evolved through all the events enacted by all the manifestations occurring within that specific vibrational frame. The eternal return can be an interesting way to access this type of hypothesis. More specifically, the eternal recurrence of the same could be conceived as related to the patterns of existence, which keep repeating themselves in a specific vibrational dimension. If so, we might be able to unravel them by repeated processes of material awareness, which would imply a quantum cosmo-ontological sensitivity. Such a possibility complies with a posthuman type of agency, where not only the human and the non-human realms bear signification, but also modalities of existence. The what is the how. Such an agency, which exceeds the notion of a monodimensional individual existence, is necessarily related to the understanding of posthumanism as a praxis. How we exist is who we are, in the same way as what we eat is what we become. Food, for instance, chemically turns into our own flesh. In such a frame, the multiverse can be perceived not only as an ontology, but as a path of self-discovery, once the self has been recognized as the others within, ultimately turning into a relational dance of ontic manifestations and events. How should there be any outside myself? There is no outside, but all sounds make us forget this. How lonely is that we forget? O Zarathustra, the animal said, to those who think as we did, as we do, all things themselves are dancing. In every now, being begins. Round every here rolls the sphere there. The center is everywhere. Bent is the path of eternity. So, can we unravel time? Maybe. What we can do is starting by unraveling repetitive patterns of existence within space-time. A posthuman approach will be of help. Posthumanism invites to think inclusively, comprehensively, and relationally, radically stretching the boundaries of human comprehension. In a genealogical relocation of humanity within multiversality, post-humanism is a criticism of humanism, anthropocentrism, and universe-centrism, and alterity within the self. Posthumanism is a recognition of those aspects which are constitutively human and still beyond human comprehension. And remember, if this universe is closed, do not worry, you can always use the rainbow. Thanks.